God's temple and burned it. They captured people and took them away. This does not to another country, after many years, God's people returned. They rebuilt the city and God's temple. In the fall, the Israelites gathered together in an area near the city gate. The men, women, and children asked Ezra to read from the Law of Moses. Ezra was a teacher and stood on a special wooden platform so the people could see him. He unrolled, opened the scroll. See that scroll? They didn't have books back then. They wound their paper up on. So they raised their hands and said, "Amen." Ezra read from the book of the law for hours. The leaders of the temple explained to the people the meaning of what they heard, and the people understood what God said. Many people began to cry. They felt bad because they hadn't followed the rules that God had given them. Well, that doesn't sound like joy either. Let's see. I guess sometimes joy and sadness go together, don't they? But the leader said to the people, "Don't cry. This is a special day. Don't be sad, for the Lord is your strength. Go and enjoy special food and drink sweet drinks. Share your food with others. Today is a day to be joyful." The teachers told the Israelites, "According to the law, God wants us to remember that he freed us from slavery. Go out into the city and gather branches, build your family a stall and a hut, and eat your meals and sleep in the hut during the celebration." The people went out into the hills and cut down branches and trees. They gathered palm branches from the myrtle trees, and they built huts and in their courtyards or in the city square. For 7 days, Ezra read from that scroll, and all the people listened. They lived in their huts and celebrated, and they were full of joy because they knew God's word. Awesome. That's a good reason to be joyful, right? Because you know that God loves you. And this is a person who looks like they're very happy, too. Awesome. So today, you all have songs with Sam.
Yay!
So you're going to learn a song, and then next week, we get to hear you sing it for the church. And we are looking forward to that so much.
Hey, we have Sunday school today.
Yes, songs with Sam. Awesome. So let's pray. Lord God, thank you for giving us the gift of joy. Just knowing that you love us gives us that joy. We ask that you bless and protect these kids. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him in my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful ones see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. And now please hear the scripture lesson from the Gospel of John.
I am the true vine, and my Father is a gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete.
Thank you, Jan. Jan has set a new standard in liturgy, wearing a sweater to match the liturgical season. She should do that on her
own. No, it was purely cool.
Lovely, you look beautiful. And the words are even more beautiful. Let's pray. Lord God, again, we're filled with gratitude for this time to be together, to sing your praises, to pray together, and to consider your word together. I ask that you would open our hearts and minds to receive the message that you have specifically for each one of us today. I ask also that you would help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning I came into the church sanctuary and walked in the door hearing the beautiful, beautiful notes ringing from the piano, and I thought, ah, Daniel's here already. And I walked in, and there he was sitting there, and it's just this gorgeous, I mean, flowery, lovely, amazing piece of music. And I said, Daniel, that's really, really beautiful. He's so talented. That's gorgeous. What song is that? And he said, you don't know what song that is? And I said, no. You don't recognize that song? I said, no. Maybe you would like to hear what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
things in life that are like that, where there's a very basic principle or a basic theme, but then there's all sorts of things that stack on top of it and adorn it and make it just so different that you almost can't recognize it. I'm reminded of watching my children learn to read cursive, right? You have a 5 or 6 year old who's pretty good at identifying the letters, you know, the basic printing. But then they look at cursive and it's like, oh, they go, because it's, you know, it's got all these loops and extra lines and things like that. And it takes a little bit of work and study for the kid to be able to discern the simple elements of those letters in between all the lines and the cursive. I mean, much less calligraphy, impossible for a new reader to read, right? Because it's so embellished. But there's a basic principle around which those letters are built. It reminds me also, same principle, in houses. Does anybody's house have additions? Do you have any additions on your house? Anybody put an addition on your house? Yes, you did, right? That's a big addition when you guys first moved in. Yeah. And so in our house as well, there were additions put on before we came in. And you could come into a house and not even recognize that there was a core basic element to that home first, and then it was expanded on. Right? But it's so helpful to know that. Many of you have been in our home, and it was just a four-room cave. And it was expanded this way, expanded that way, expanded this way, right? It's so helpful to know this is the original structure. This is the basic structure of this house. And these are the additions, because then you know where the house is strong, which are the supporting walls, which walls you can't knock down, because then you're going to lose the whole house, right? When you understand the core around which it is built and what is added on, you can understand the whole thing better. I want you to hang on to this idea of there being sort of a foundational or a root principle that can have a whole lot of extra detail put around it. But the root is the thing that will be most important or most definitive. Okay, so hang on to that, and we're going to change subjects. What brings you joy? What makes you really, really happy? I'm thinking it's for Daniel. It's sitting down in front of that piano. Right? Something tells me about it. I thought asking Daniel to just play on the piano was sort of like giving Luke Connor a microphone. Like, oh my gosh, it's just going to go on and on and on. That just occurred to me. Because this is where the joy is, right? He loves to talk, right? Daniel loves to play. Where do you get joy? Rhetorical question. I'm going to tell you about some joy that I saw going on yesterday. Bobby and George and I were down in the parlor yesterday, beginning the renovation, the prep work on the walls for that parlor renovation project. And, you know, we're spraying down the walls and all these things and doing all moving furniture and scraping away. I have to say that that's the most fragrant trustees project that I've ever been a part of, and I never thought that I would talk about trustees as being fragrant. But if you want to get wallpaper off the wall, I found out yesterday, insider tip from George, you don't just spray it with water to soak it, you spray it with diluted downy fabric softener. So if you walked into the church this morning and got a nice sweet scent, you go down to the offices and take a breath, that's downy, right? There's no static cling in the So like when I walked in, I was like knocked down by this, you know, smell of downy, so that was wonderful. And then a couple hours later, that smell pivots to this very sharp smell of oil-based primer that we were putting on. Tons of scents. But mostly what I noticed was the joy that George and Bobby had while they were working. It's fun for me too. But these are guys who love to work with their hands. It's so much satisfaction out of being able to strip that wallpaper off and put up that primer on that wood. And it was just really fun, and I thank both of you for working yesterday. It is a joy to make something with your hands. For me, it was fun to do the wallpaper. I get more joy from cooking. I made lunch for my girlfriends this week on Wednesday, put together potato corn chowder, and fed my friends some soup for lunch. That brought me great joy to work with my hands. You might get joy from going on a hike. You might get joy from listening to music. You might get joy from going out to get a manicure or a cup of coffee with a friend. There's whole industries that are built on trying to provide people joy, right? You will be happy, you will have joy if you just do this. Like I'm thinking, showing my age, you remember the old Toyota commercials where they would jump up in the air and they would freeze up up there? What a feeling. Toyota, right? They have trees up there. Jumping for joy. If you just buy this new car, you will have so much joy. And as a side note, we should have a really joyful church. Do you know 3 people in this church got new cars last week? Right? I think it bodes really well for the rest of us. Next week it'll be 3 more. Right? So much joy to just speed down the road and that new car smell. You know, no climbing or bonking like my car on the church this morning. That's, oh man, we have joy when we have a new car. Or like just go down to Jordan's Furniture, which is like our home away from home with the Fisher family. You walk in there and it's like jelly beans and liquid fireworks and music and beanstalk climbing thing and firecrackers and movies. Oh my gosh, and furniture. Right? Like how much joy is contained in that experience? Or maybe the pinnacle joy machine that we know of in our culture, which is Disney. You go there and you must have fun. You must be happy right now. They're gonna happy the crap out of you in Disney, you know what I mean? Like it's like an assault of joy and happiness. This is the most magical place on earth. All of these things, excuse my language, all of these things are real experiences of joy. They are, they're legitimate, they bring joy to our heart. But I wanna ask you this. Well, I want you to notice this, that none of them are permanent, and none of them are guaranteed. Not one of the things that I listed. There may be a time in our lives when we can't, or you may be there already, where you can't work with your hands the way that you used to. Does that mean you have no joy now? There may be a time when you can't go on a hike because your mobility becomes limited. Does that mean you don't have joy? Maybe a time Daniel doesn't play, or Hugh doesn't have a microphone in his hand. Does that mean that they don't have joy? What if you can't afford a new car or a trip to Disney? What if Jordan's burns down? And Jordan's can't ever burn down. Or the Fishers will die. But also, they have a liquid fireworks, and so I'm thinking that will help. Again, I thought about this. But what if they go away? Do you lose your joy then? What if the CD player breaks, or your streaming, whatever, iTunes breaks, and you can't listen to music? Do you lose your joy? Have you noticed how there are some people who really have very little as far as the list of joys that I just gave you, and yet it just seems like they always have that joy with them? You know, they're just that type of person. They just kind of radiate some joy, even if they have a very limited situation. And have you noticed that there's some people who have everything on the joys list? They're young and strong, and they've got money, and they can go places and buy joy experiences, and they still aren't very joyful? Yes, everybody knows somebody like that. So maybe it isn't that joy is contained in the list of things that I talked about, but maybe that list of things is more like the surface stuff, the embellishments, the decorations, the add-ons to a principle of joy that is more foundational. Actually, that's exactly the case, especially as Christians. We are people who have a root song in our heart. Maybe Amazing Grace. It might be exactly that song. That is the source of the identity of the source of our joy. As Christians, we're people who know, who have come to believe that the creator of all of this loves us. That this is not random coincidence. We're not just walking around here because of a fluke of DNA somewhere in a certain distance from the sun. It's not just chaos and randomness. That is the saddest thing for me when people say that they're atheistic or agnostic. Like, absolutely respect where you are, but gosh, to think that this is just random? To think that there's no purpose? To think that the force behind this beautiful universe doesn't know you and love you? To think that you're unknown and unloved? Gosh, that's alienating for me. So we know that as people of faith, that this is not random happenstance. This is a creative force who loves us, who made us. And not only that, we understand that the destructive forces that exist here, sin and death, have no power over us. Sin and death are real, But they don't have a claim on us as Christians. We know that because of Jesus. Jesus showed us how to live our lives. But then when he died and God raised him on the third day, what he said to us is that death does not have a victory here. Death doesn't end my relationship with you. And the thing that causes death, sin, doesn't have a victory here. So we're people who are safe from the chaotic forces of the world. We're safe from sin and from death. We are saved from fear. We are saved from thinking we're a random accident. We are saved. Saved. That is at the core of who we are as Christians. We are saved. And that means we have joy. At a basic and a fundamental level, we are joyful. And so when we step out into the world and like we are late for work and we spilled our coffee and we got in a fender bender, we got a fight with our coworker and look down and our shoes don't match, and, you know, like one of those days, those are all decoration things, those are all extra things, and still the core that we have is joy. Is joy. Even on the bad days. Sometimes the decorations are beautiful, sometimes the extra stuff is not so beautiful, but as a core, we have joy. And so this is the question for each of us in the room today, including myself. Where are you with this? This is some introspection in your prayer and meditation. Where are you with this? How dependent are you on the little extras, the purchasable joy that I was talking about, for feeling joy? Do you depend on things from the outside to come in and make you feel happy today? And if those things go away, now you're a grouch. Or even when the external circumstances aren't all that wonderful, are you able to tap into that identity, that saved identity, and feel joy? This whole year, we're talking about who we're becoming. Who are we becoming? We aspire to become people who are rooted in the joy of our salvation, who really invest in that part of our identity. So if we have sparkles and magic and fireworks and fun things, that's great. And if we don't, that's okay. Because our joy comes from the Lord. Amen. One way to feed joy is to come to the table that Christ prepared for us so long ago and invites us to share in every time that we get together across the ages and the centuries. We're around the table with all the believers. And so it's time for us to celebrate Holy Communion. The table is open for this service. That means you come if you want to come. We serve grape juice and gluten-free bread for our service. You'll come up the center aisles as directed by the ushers and kneel, receive the communion elements when they are given to you, and then wait for a dismissal. And when you're dismissed, you can go back to your seats by the side aisles, but not on that one because of Bobby. All right.
I'll be gone.
Okay. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore the ark upon the waters, saving Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. When your people forsook your covenant, the prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, And on your holy mountain, he heard your still small voice. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your spirit led him into the wilderness, where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross for our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, when we, your people, prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts during these 40 days of Lent, that we may be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." When the supper, and so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The table is prepared. Please come. Thank you. Lord God, you are the source of our joy. Help us to root ourselves deeply into that identity. Thank you for all that you give us. And we ask that you would receive this offering as an expression of our joy, our thanks for all that you do in this world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Fast food. going to receive donations so we can give it to the UMC in Wilmington, so we can give it to homeless children in Africa. You can write a check out to our church, the Aldersgate, and then we will give it to UMC in Wilmington.
Right, so that collection goes to Church World Service for hungry people in Africa. But we'll just write one big donation from our church. So if you're interested in giving to that, you can, again, write it to our church. Just make sure it says 30-hour famine on it so that the counters know what your donation is for. We're proud of you guys. I think we're sending 7, 8, 9 kids to that event next week. And so we'll miss you on next Sunday morning, but we know that you will be over there hungry. Right, thank you. And then they're coming to our house that afternoon for confirmation, and we always serve them dinner. I think we're having a double dinner. All right, proud of you guys. Sam, you have an announcement about the breakfast.
Yes, breakfast. The first 100 people are free. It's a St. Patrick's Day themed breakfast. It will not feature ham, but it'll have everything else. It'll be fantastic. You're gonna have a great time.
When is it?
Saturday from 8 to 10:30.
Okay, what's that? This Saturday.
Yeah, we're green.
Yeah. All right. Invite your friends. It's a great way to invite a friend to come into the building for the first time if they haven't been here and get exposed to the community.
Unless you're at the 30-hour famine, then we don't want you.
Right. Yeah, we'll be eating. They will
We will eat bacon and think of you.
That's great. Out in the foyer on the little half circle table, out that way, there are a whole bunch of books. These came from the church parlor. We had something like a library, and we're just going to break that up and send those books home. So those are all free for the taking. Please look through them. There's a number of Max Lucado books that people have studied over time that have accumulated. Those are wonderful. There's reference books. There's Bibles. So please take a look and take anything you want. Take as much as you want. It's less for me to take the recycler because that's where they're going to go next. So you have a couple weeks to do that. Also this afternoon, we're going to, many of us are going down to the Woburn Showcase Theater for a 1-10 showing of The Shack. The LaMonicas are unable to use their tickets today. They have 4 tickets, and so that means I have 4 tickets. So if there's anybody who kind of last minute would like to join in on that, I have tickets for you. Just talk to me after church. All right, for celebration and thanks. Nobody said anything on the sheet. So, tell me, who do we celebrate or thank this week? Yes, Bobby?
An anonymous donor who has stepped forward and funded the remainder of the funds to tile our foyer.
Okay, so thank you to, in case you didn't hear, an anonymous donor who's given funds to retile the rest of the foyer. All right, anonymous. Be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.